The Iron Sheik was a big name in professional wrestling, but he paid a heavy price for the fame. This is the tragic real-life story of the Iron Sheik. In an industry of scripted events, plot lines, and characters, it would be easy enough to imagine that the Iron Sheik is actually just some dude from Ohio. This couldn't be further from the truth. According to Lou Friedman's book Pro Wrestling, A Comprehensive Reference Guide, the future Sheik really spent his early days in Iran's capital, Tehran. The honorific of his wrestling character wasn't very accurate, though, because his family was actually quite poor. According to Bedoun, Hossein Khosrow Ali Vaziri was born in 1943 to a pistachio farming family. He spent his early days without amenities such as running water, and as he grew up, he had to go through mandatory military service. This was presumably no picnic, but as a silver lining, it did give him ample time to hone his wrestling craft and even become the Army's wrestling champion. So how did a young man from Iran end up dominating stateside pro wrestling rings? By being disillusioned by the mysterious death of his hero. As Bedoun tells us, the reason the Iron Sheik became interested in wrestling is a man named Gholam Reza Takhti, an Olympic gold medalist in freestyle wrestling. The extremely famous Takhti hailed from the same neighborhood as the future Sheik, so he was a natural role model for Vaziri, and the young man soon found himself on a similar career path. Only 3 years after taking up wrestling, Vaziri was a national high school champion. While Vaziri's love for wrestling would endure for decades to come, the man who inspired him met an untimely end. Takhti died in 1968, and although the official explanation was that he'd killed himself, there were whispers that the athlete had been taken care of because he'd been getting too political. The news made young Vaziri realize that his trajectory and Takhti's were too close for comfort. He said, "I knew I had to leave. If Iran was not good for Takhti, it was not good for me." And so, the Sheik went to America. As Lou Friedman's Pro Wrestling and Comprehensive Reference Guide tells us, the 1980s was not a good time to be a famous foreign villain. The Iron Sheik was able to draw heat and become successful, but it reflected pretty badly on his personal life. The Sheik was such a successful baddie that, as Yahoo Sports notes, he earned up to $500,000 a year in his heyday, somewhere between $1.2 million and $1.6 million in today's money, adjusted for inflation and depending on the year. Unfortunately, this money came at a cost that was far higher than getting booed on a nightly basis. Multiple wrestling fans attempted to beat Sheik up or even stab him. In an interview with Vice, he recalled one instance when he had to leave a venue hiding in an ambulance, terrified of the mobs outside. Things got so bad that he started to fear for the safety of his family and stopped taking them on the road. Though the Iron Sheik's evil foreigner gimmick and various villainous antics may have been the most enduring image of his wrestling career, it should be remembered that he was also a very, very good wrestler. Bleacher Report notes that when he still lived in Iran, he was a common sight in international tournaments. Things didn't exactly cool down when he moved stateside, and Bedoun tells us that his accolades of this era include the gold medal in the 1971 Amateur Athletic Union Championship, as well as two silvers in the 2 years before. He was also a good enough wrestling coach to serve a stint as an assistant coach for the U.S. Olympic team. The Sheik was very proud of his medals, and much like Olympic gold-winning pro wrestler Kurt Angle after him, he liked to keep his bling on full display during his TV appearances. Unfortunately, this proved to be too tempting for some, and the Sheik reportedly lost his precious prizes when they were stolen from his hotel room in Newark, New Jersey. It would be easy to think that after a long, hard day of acting as a magnet for America's hatred, loathing, and dropkicks, the Iron Sheik would like nothing better than to drop the character and kick back as himself. Unfortunately, Bleacher Report tells us that he's been known to find this quite difficult. When he was starting out in the 1970s, the Sheik came from a legitimate amateur wrestling background, and he found it hard to accept the scripted nature of pro wrestling. Turns out, the Sheik was a good learner, and as he settled into his character, he became so adept at being phony that he often stayed in the role in his downtime. This was, of course, a bit of a problem, since the Iron Sheik was a cartoonish wrestling heel. Sometimes, things got so bad that he started randomly dictating what individual people could buy and eat while they were shopping in the supermarket. Considering what a massive name the Sheik was in his prime, the modern equivalent for this would probably be if the MCU villain Thanos suddenly ambushed you at Walmart to berate you about the amount of microwave meals in your cart.
"I am inevitable."
The Iron Sheik might have caused plenty of in-ring havoc in his prime, but as the Sportster tells us, one of his most notorious victims was the very concept of kayfabe itself. Kayfabe, if you're not familiar with wrestling jargon, is the pro wrestling industry's system of keeping up appearances. Basically, the heroic faces and villainous heels play their designated roles and steer clear of each other in public, no matter how well they privately get along. In 1987, the Sheik inadvertently put a massive dent in this idea when he ended up in hot water with a fellow wrestler, Hacksaw Jim Duggan. As the Associated Press reported at the time, the pair were driving to an event together and were arrested when it turned out they had marijuana and, in the case of the Sheik, cocaine. This was a minor problem. However, as Bleacher Report notes, the huge problem was that Duggan and the Sheik were a face and a heel, happily traveling in the same car. This caused massive waves in the wrestling circles, and as a result, the World Wrestling Federation promptly fired both men. Though the Iron Sheik has been a stern and dedicated athlete for most of his days, Yahoo Sports tells us that his life and career alike have suffered from his long-term substance abuse issues. He was already struggling with a crack cocaine addiction during his heyday, but that was far from the only intoxicant he developed a taste for. What's worse, he was known to mix alcohol with whatever drugs he could get his hands on. According to Bleacher Report, the Sheik's devotion to both his sport and his Shiite Muslim beliefs meant that he steered clear of the more carnal aspects of life for longer than most. Likewise, he didn't bother with drink and drugs until the pro wrestling community's liberal approach to narcotic substances swept him off his feet. Though the Sheik has attempted to clean up his act at times, he's had more than his share of relapses, and his addiction has bled into his personal life as well. He's had at least one bender that ended in a minor heart attack, and at one point, his wife temporarily left him because of his drug use. Going purely by his character, the Iron Sheik might seem like the most self-assured person in the world. However, the man behind the impressive mustache has gone through some dark days, and he's reportedly struggled with depression in various points of his life. Per Badoon, the first time the Sheik fell in deep depression was when he was still living in Iran, and his idol, famed wrestler Gholam Reza Takhti, died in what were thought to be somewhat suspicious circumstances. Remember, this is what prompted the future pro wrestling legend to start a new life in the United States. As Bleacher Report tells us, another even more hurtful loss came in 2003 with the murder of the Sheik's daughter. Though his immediate reaction was to swear off drugs in order to better aid his grieving family, he eventually found the grief too much to bear and started using again. It was during this hazy period that he started his late-life side gig as shock jock Howard Stern's foul-mouthed guest, and Bleacher Report describes his tantrums of the time as, quote, "fueled by drugs and emotional destitution." Fortunately, the Sheik was able to kick drugs after his wife finally left him. They eventually reconciled, and by 2013, he seemed to occupy a much healthier mental space. A professional wrestler can't get to the top of the industry without experiencing his share of pain, and the Iron Sheik's tolerance for unpleasant physical sensation is quite significant. Unfortunately, even the Sheik has his limits, and as Yahoo Sports tells us, his thoroughly worn down and broken body reached them long ago. The Sheik's wife, Carol, said in 2013, "He's in such great pain almost all the time." A part of this nigh-constant torment comes from the natural wear and tear from a life as a pro wrestler, but Mrs. Vaziri names a pair of botched knee surgeries around 2003 as the main culprit. She said, "He hurts everywhere, but the knees are really painful. He told me, 'Carol, I hurt from the top of my head to the bottom of my toes.'" This kind of constant torture makes one suspect that if the Sheik could rewind time, he'd go for a very different career path. However, the wrestling legend appears to adamantly disagree. He said, "I love wrestling and I would do it all again, but it is a very, very hard business. There is nothing about it that is easy." If you or anyone you know is struggling with addiction issues, help is available. Visit the Substance Abuse and Mental Health Services Administration, SAMHSA, website or contact SAMHSA's National Helpline at 1-800-662-HELP, 4357.